here we are.
Thanks for indulging me and hearing a little bit of the background of and the kind of breaking the fourth wall and going behind the scenes of how writing happens. It's something I'm super interested in. But we better talk about your book. So 4.6 billion years in 12 pithy chapters. I love the word. I love how pithy the word pithy is, too, by the way. It's such a fun word.
It's got a nice mouth feel to it. I can't say it very well because I'm missing several teeth, but you know. I was trying to keep it short. Somebody said, it actually looks quite a thick book. This book mm-hmm. would drive a Toyota Beef, but then when you think about it, the history of life is very long, and if the history of life was keeping a week per page diary, it would be 200 billion pages long or something. So I've just sort of cut to the edited bits. But actually, I've given you a bonus because it's actually 5.5 billion years, because I actually take life from now to a billion years in the future. That's what we scientists technically call making shit up. Based on some extrapolation. Of course, a lot of it's making stuff up because science is never final. I mean, I've tried to base it as much as I can on the latest evidence. But what I'm doing is I'm telling a story, and I didn't want to interrupt. I didn't want to be didactic. I didn't want to talk down too much to the readers. I just wanted to, like, tell a bedtime story. It even starts once upon a time. Once upon a time, a giant star was dying, and it became the supernova that produced all the stuff that we're made of.
Well, I would love to start there because we actually haven't I would say most of the time that we're talking about evolution on this show, it's been about the last billion years. And often it tends to skew pretty human-centric as well. But I would say something that we haven't covered a lot is exactly what you just said, from the Big Bang to the origin of life on Earth, and then when life started. That's something that I would love if you could share.
Yeah, sure. I mean, my book is in the end human-centric because it's a human story. I mean, if I were a giraffe, I'd write a different story, but the beginning is quite the same. And my first chapter is so pithy that actually I tell kind of 9/10 of the history of life on Earth before I get to page 14. And this is the reason, it's partly because we don't know a great deal about it, but it does start some billions of years in the past with a giant star that is getting to the end of its life. And stars, especially giant stars, have a problem. They only live on a knife edge between two forces. One is the fusion furnace that creates the energy to inflate the star, and the gravity that's trying to squash it in. And so the star is always a very delicate balance of forces. But after a while, the star runs out of hydrogen to fuse into helium. Now, it gets the most energy from doing that. And when it runs out of hydrogen, it has to fuse the helium to make carbon and other things. And this is more complicated and doesn't produce as much energy. And then it's burning its way, creating more and more elements, until one day it has all the energy of a wet lettuce leaf, and the gravity wins. And the gravity, because a star is I'm talking about stars much bigger than the sun, because this star is gigantic, it will implode in a split second. But the implosion creates such a huge... The implosion is the one thing. And imagine all that mass whizzing to the centre in a second after millions of years. It just gets to the point where it literally can't hold it up anymore, and it goes over the edge and goes whomp right into the middle. Now, that's not the main thing. The main thing is the rebound. The rebound from this is the supernova explosion. All those things crammed together in a small space go, and they do all sorts of chemical reactions about which I know nothing. And then there's this immense explosion in which the whole power of the star is just radiated out in minutes. And it's so bright that it can be seen across the whole universe. I mean, the most distant galaxies we only really know about because of supernovas. The rest of the galaxy we wouldn't even see was there. But what happens with a supernova, it creates two things. It creates a huge gravitational shock wave that goes through the vicinity. It will extinguish any life on any of its planets, if it has any, and all the planets within several light years around, once the light gets there, of course. So this gravitational shock travels throughout space, but also so does all the other stuff that it's made and it's lost in its old age, all these chemical elements and some extremely exotic ones like uranium and iron and things that it's made in its final moments. And these get spread across the universe, surfing this gravitational shockwave. Now, sometime later, because matter in space is not distributed uniformly, sometimes it's just really empty space and sometimes it's clumped together at an incredible density of one hydrogen atom per cubic meter. And in these rather more dense regions of dust and ice and gas, the gravitational shock wave carrying its freight of exotic material like iron and uranium and silicon and aluminium will compress it together, and gravity will work on anything, however small, but especially if it's larger. So when the cloud gets larger and more compressed, it kind of gets into a runaway process, and it will start swirling around like a, you know, like a cinnamon Danish. And at the beginning is so compressed that hydrogen starts to fuse to create helium and produces heat and light, and that's a new star. That's our sun. That's how it starts. And all the other bits of cinnamon Danish hanging around the other side, they condense to form the planets. Now, the planets weren't just like the system we have now. The solar system we have now is quite orderly. Back in the end, it was kind of dodging cars. It was complete chaos. There was loads and loads of planets. Jupiter probably started much closer to the sun than it is now and moved out. Some other planets moved in. And things kept knocking into each other. So we have our infant Earth, which is coagulating, and all the heavy elements go to the middle, like iron and nickel, and form this white, red-hot core. And all the heavy elements, like all the radioactive ones, like uranium and thorium, they go as well, and they start producing radioactivity, and that keeps the planet warm and on the boil, which is important later. But the Earth, the surface of the Earth is nothing like Earth. It's molten magma, all of it. And it keeps being smashed into by other planetary bodies during a period called the period of heavy bombardment, which is a marvellous understatement. During one particular episode, a planet the size of Mars smashed into the Earth, a kind of glancing blow, and squeezed off most of the Earth's crust into space. And that coagulated to form another world, the Moon, which is why the Moon is quite large for a satellite of a small planet such as ours, and why its composition is pretty similar. Now, most moons of most planets are rather different from the parent planet because they're usually captured asteroids from somewhere else. But the Earth's Moon is rather strange and unusual. But then what happened? The atmosphere of the infant Earth, still being bombarded with stuff, is full of, it's an unbreathable fog of methane and hydrogen and water vapor and rusty bikes and half-eaten pork pies and brass bedsteads and all kinds of other stuff. And then what happens is the Earth slowly cools down, and it cools down so much that all that water vapor can condense as rain. And it rained for millions and millions of years, even more than it rains in Seattle. And it rained so much that oceans were created. So after being a ball of molten magma, the Earth was a water world without Kevin Costner. It was just the water world. And there were some comets, which are icy, which came in and added a few bit more water and some exotic carbon compounds. Mm. But the Earth was still pretty heavy. The Earth was still pretty active, and as a result of all the heat coming up, it's just like having a pan of water on the stove. You get these convection cells coming up. The heat bubbles to the surface, spreads out, and then moves down again at the edges. You get these kind of convection cells in the molten rock in the Earth. Now, all the molten rock in the Earth is kind of gloopy but dense, but on the surface, as the Earth cooled, the crust formed. On the surface of the Earth, the crust formed, and this was a kind of souffle-like froth of light elements, oxygen, silicon, and aluminium, which basically make up most rocks. But because of the heat, they'd be slowly pushed apart and subducted back in and then glommed together again. And that was the beginning of plate tectonics. So you get this ocean above, all these jets of magma still coming up through into the ocean and bubbling out, and water at the edge of tectonic plates being subducted into the mantle to produce this. And it was in this chaos and disaster that life began. Now, this is pretty much making stuff up, but there are people who've got a good idea of how life could have begun and the most likely. Now, Charles Darwin speculated that life could have started in some warm little pond somewhere. He didn't say this in any of his books. It was just in a letter to someone else. But actually, the warm little pond was, you know, if this was a warm little pond, it was a gothic death metal warm little pond. It was a superheated hydrothermal vent at the bottom of the ocean where mineral-rich water gushes out at 300 degrees, but it's still water because it's superheated and saturated under pressure. And then you get all these rocks that are crystallizing and condensing out because it gets to the cold water and it just condenses out. And all the rocks are full of little holes. So what life started as little scummy membranes that formed across microscopic holes in the rock where some of the minerals landed. Because of the convection, because they became turbulent, they lost their speed and dumped their minerals in these tiny microscopic holes in the rock, which act as kind of catalysts for chemical reactions. So life began as little scummy, soapy membranes across tiny holes in the volcanic rock, where things were more ordered and were calmer and chemical reactions could happen. And slowly these little scummy membranes would bud off more scummy membranes full of chemicals. And after, for a while, scummy membranes of various sizes were all there were. But because of the chemistry in it, some of these scummy membranes had a chemical template whereby they became more like their parents' scummy membranes than they otherwise would have been. And then natural selection starts and then life happens. And this happened, not very long after the Earth actually formed. I mean, there are signs, more of a ghost of an echo of a passing smile remembered in a dream, that life was around 4.1 billion years. And it's the tiniest bit of evidence. It's almost romantically tiny. There's a crystals of zircon, a bit like cubic zirconia in, you know, flashy rings, but microscopic. And this zircon was a mineral worn away from a rock that once existed but has been completely eroded away. And inside this tiny zircon is a little smut of graphite, like pencil lead, that shows a little bit of just subtle chemistry that it was made in a living organism. So, you know, inferential. So life began quite soon after the Earth was formed. But it took time to become established. But when it did, oh boy, I mean, there's evidence quite disputed for macroscopic life, you know, bacterial scuts of slime like you see on your pond, about 3.7 billion. But that's quite disputed. But the earliest life with which everyone agrees is about 3.5 billion. And by that time, living organisms were making reefs. Reefs of bacterial slime that you could see from space if you were a little alien on a spaceship passing by. And by that time, life had spread from the deep depths to the sunlit surface layers of the ocean. I mean, it had arrived. Amid all this chaos and tumult, life had arrived, and it arrived pretty quick. And once it arrived, it was very hard to get rid of. But that's what happened. That was the very earliest days of Earth. So what happened then? Was the king? Carry on saying. You've got to physically interrupt me, Shane. Otherwise, I'll just continue until I fall over.